All the world was made. Brothers and sisters, Even if a person is caught in some transgression, you, who are spiritual, should correct that one in a gentle spirit. Look into yourself, so that you may also not be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks they are something when they are nothing, they are deluding themselves. Each one must examine their own work, and then they will have reason to boast with regard to themselves alone, and not with regard to someone else. For each will bear their own load. One who is being instructed in the word should share all good things with his instructor. Make no mistake, God is not mocked. For a person will reap only what they sow, because the one who sows for his flesh will reap corruption from the flesh. But the one who sows from the Spirit will reap eternal life from the Spirit. Let us not grow tired of doing good, for in due time we shall reap our harvest if we do not give up. So then, we will have the opportunity. Let us all do good to all, but especially those who belong to the family of faith. Praise be to God always.
Since you were faithful in small matters, I will give you great responsibilities. Come, share your master's joy. Then the one who had received the one talent came forward, and he said, Master, I knew you were a demanding person, harvesting where you did not plant, and gathering where you did not sow. So out of fear, I went off, and I buried your talent in the ground. Here it is back. His master said to him in reply, You wicked and lazy servant, so you knew that I harvest where I did not plant, and gather where I did not sow. Should you not then have put my money in a bank, so that I could have got it back with interest on my return? Now then, take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. But from the one who has not, even that which he has will be taken away. And throw this useless servant into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. This is the truth. Peace be with you. It's the Greek word talanton. And talanton is also a weight or a measure. But so important that this parable has been in the Western Christian tradition, in the Western world, that we've taken the word for weight, talent, and applied it to all the gifts and circumstances and abilities that are part of our lives. This word talent. It is a very mysterious parable in one way. In that, the man who has the most at the end of this parable receives another talent in addition. And the poor man who did just simply guard what had been confided to him and gave it back whole and entire is yelled at, thrown out basically in the prison, and that what he had was taken and given away to someone else. So we recall that in this chapter 25 of St. Matthew, our Lord is giving a series of parables dealing with time and the preparation for the end of the world. And in doing so, what we're meant to consider, why it's coupled together with St. Paul's epistle today, is that as St. Paul says, that if we sow and lay our fields, we will surely harvest if we don't stop. That this work continues to go on. So we have a question of perseverance here. That's part of what is involved in this parable. Now, a talent, so what is a talent then as a measure? One of the things to take in addition to note in this parable is that each is given according to their ability. Each one receives what they're able to actually deal with. That's what we're told. That's the first thing to note. The second is what are these things being confided, these talents? In the classical world of our Lord, a talent, the talanton, was the largest weight of measurement. It was 75 pounds, usually of silver or gold. And of course, 75 pounds of gold is worth, in today's prices, about $1.5 million. So what is being confided to every single one of these men, these stewards, is a profound trust and confidence. I bring it up because sometimes we see 5 and 2 and 1 and we think, well, the poor guy who got 1, it isn't much. But even that guy still got $1.5 million committed to his care in this goal. So it's an enormous trust and confidence given to each of these individuals. This master is not, he's demanding injustice, but he is not someone who does not give confidence and trust. This is an important part of the parable. As our Lord is preparing us for the day of judgment, he's reminding us that yes, the judgment is just, but preceding it is the magnificent trust and confidence given to each by God. So that when we look at it, what happens is, two of them understand what they're supposed to do with this trust, make it grow, and have something for when this, the master returns. And we're told the master's gone for a long time. So when something goes on for a long time, there's always the possibility we just give up. It's too long. It takes too much of an effort. And we stop. That's St. Paul saying, we will harvest if we do not give up. We have to persevere. So all three men in their own way persevere. Two of them make a profit. And obviously the master is delighted. He's doubled their money. And so you imagine that the first man with 5 talents, he's been confided over $7 million to work with, and he comes back and says, I got you another 7. By the end of the parable, he gets another 1.5 million. So he's done pretty well at this, at the moment of judgment and having to give account. And the same one, the same with the one who gained 2. And you notice that what is also said to them is not just simply that they are rewarded for having made a profit. They enter into the very possessions, as it's told in the parable, of the joy of the master. It's not just that they're rewarded as stewards. They are brought into a specific joy, happiness, pleasure, which belongs to the master himself. And that's what's being held out to us also at the day of judgment. Now in this parable, one of the things that happens, besides just giving up, but the other possibility that happens to us is that with the idea of justice, that there's a certain paralysis might set in. He gives me a talent. I have 1.5 million in gold. What if 2008 happens again? If I invest this in the market, what if it crashes and he comes back in 2009 and I don't even have 1.5 million to give him? That's awful. So I know what I'm going to do to make sure he gets back exactly what he confided to me. I'll bury it. You know, 75 pounds sounds a lot, but gold is very heavy, and it's not a very big thing. He buries it. So when he comes to the moment of rendering account, he's quite happy that he didn't lose anything. We're not told that he even knows what the other two men have done, but he's quite pleased that the market didn't crash, he didn't invest it, he didn't lose anything, and he gets back exactly what belongs to him. And we're told, because not only is the master just, it sounds like he does a bit more than that. He harvests in places where he hasn't actually planted. He takes, he has a way of gaining things from others. And so what happens with the third man is he's paralyzed. He becomes paralyzed by fear of the judgment coming. So part of what our Lord is telling us in this parable is that there is a day of judgment coming. Persevere. Use all of the gifts, the talents, the word, the abilities and the circumstances in your life. But what are given to us is what God does to make us good. The collaboration is what is there to make ourselves better, to work with these things. And God on Judgment Day will expect that we are better people than with the initial gifts that are given to us. And so the man who's paralyzed by fear, by merely the idea of justice coming, has missed the whole point of the collaboration with the riches that are confided to him. And so our Lord in this parable is very simple. He's telling us that we must collaborate, we must persevere. We each, in all of our varieties, each have our own gifts. But those gifts cannot just simply be protected, so that I just simply say that I'm good enough. Good enough doesn't work in this parable. It's always the idea that there is good that is granted to us by the Master. We collaborate and work with it to make it grow. And yes, we wait for the day of judgment when their accounting will have to be given. But we do so in a collaboration with the expectation of a reward to come. May God grant us the wisdom, the light, the strength, and the perseverance to use the good that He has given us and its great weight and value to become better, to follow our Lord, and embracing the gospel to live in imitation of the Sacred Heart. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
ancestors. Now accept these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them in place of their earthly gifts. Grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ in his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of Sister Catherine and the community of the Blessed Sacrament. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Thank you.
wisdom of your grace and guide him. May your compassion and assistance sustain us all the days of our lives. Through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, we glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Astray, you brought us back to your spiritual fold by his royal blood. Through your grace and the favor of your only Son, we implore you to accept this bloodless sacrifice from our sinful hands, and through it to forgive our sins. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Remember your death, O Lord. We profess your resurrection
rescue. On that fearful Lord, have compassion on us. Have mercy on us in your kindness, and forgive our sins in your mercy. For this your church in glory went through you, and with you in glory your Father's name.
Teachers.
for the strengthening of your holy church. Remember those who serve your holy altar and forgive their sins, that they may reach your joyful dwellings. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who have left this world and have gone to you. Lead them to your joyful dwellings and blot out all their sins. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we multiply mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant us, O God, to be departed, and forgive the sins we have committed without our full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. You have united, O Lord, your divinity with our humanity, and our humanity with your divinity.
God, for reverence and humility, and asking for mercy and compassion.
holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, who is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our being lead to the forgiveness of our sins and for eternal life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Oh,
But Father, how can we who are unworthy thank you for your grace? For you have given us this divine gift and have made us worthy to share in the body and blood of your only begotten Son who saved us. Through him and with him, glory and honor are due to you and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, you are worshipped and you are holy. Bless and forgive the priests who are stewards of your people and of your holy church. Forgive the servers of your divine mysteries and all the faithful who have shared in this sacrifice. Care for orphans. Help widows, assist the poor and the distressed, satisfy the hungry, and protect all who call upon your holy name in every place. May your name be glorified with that of your Father and your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving and consubstantial with you, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.